We welcome Dr. Alan Berger today or tonight, whether it's nighttime or day, to continue our look at emotional sobriety in the 12 steps. And before we start, I want to congratulate Alan on his 53rd anniversary of being sober. That is pretty awesome. And I congratulate him enormously. It's wonderful. So that was on August 1st, I believe. If I'm wrong, please tell me and I'll adjust. Alan will take another in-depth look at the Step 5 Principle and Emotional Sobriety Core Value. So this is a continuation of the series titled Emotional Sobriety in the 12 Steps, which Alan and Herb Kagan, who is also here, have put on for our group every first Monday of the month in last year and all this year. And that is just fantastic that we've been able to get them every single month. So I'm really so pleased to welcome Alan and come on in. Can you unmute? I don't know. I don't see
I
you.
am
So
unmuted. I am
where are you?
unmuted.
Oh, there you are. Hooray. Congratulations, Alan.
Well, thank you so much, Susie, for recognizing my 53rd anniversary. Now, if you do the math, if I am 55, does that mean I got sober when I was 2 years old?
I don't know. Did you?
No, I'm 72, so I was fortunate to find this program when I was 19. And it's been an incredible journey, you know, how to summarize 53 years. And I think the best way, if I can take a few minutes before we jump into step five to talk about that, is that I think it's best to think about recovery as a developmental process. You see, think about that if what we say is true, is that all of us, for whatever reason, got stuck in our development at some particular point in the process. And we can think of recovery as an unsticking process, right? It helps us get past those impasses, those stuck points, or as other people call them, sick points in our life where we're stuck in this consciousness that is typically quite immature and undifferentiated. You'll hear me use that term a lot when I give my talks. I'll speak a little bit about differentiation here in a minute. But when I look back, I can really see the unfolding of a consciousness that today I would call the unfolding of a consciousness of emotional sobriety. Because what it looked like early on in my recovery when I was 19 and still quite obviously immature, not just chronologically, but more even so emotionally, is I just was so dependent on things being a certain way for me to be okay. In psychology, we call it being looking for environmental support. Looking for my environment, whatever's in my environment or in the psychological field I'm operating in, to give me self-esteem, to make me feel okay about myself, to regulate me. And if things didn't go the way that I wanted them to, either consciously or unconsciously, I had no idea how to cope with that disappointment. You see, one of the things that I look back and I see that was so clear. And so many things have gotten clear in this journey. But one of the things that was close, so clear, is I had no idea how to deal with disappointment. None. No concept. Is if things didn't go my way, I did not know how to handle it. I'd come up with, you know, either I'd globalize it, say, I guess life is just always going to be fucked. I'm never going to get what I want, that kind of thing. Or I'd go the other way, you know, and I'd get mad and angry about it and try to control and manipulate the situation to get what I want. But I had no idea on how to take acceptance and to use acceptance as a way of coping. It was like it was never on my radar that acceptance was even a possibility. I mean, you know, you'll hear Herb and I say a lot of times, we don't know what we don't know. And I didn't know that there was another path called acceptance in terms of dealing with things in my life. And I'll tell you, that key in itself, and now it doesn't mean, and please don't mistake what I'm saying, to say that if I get disappointed, that boy, acceptance is right at my fingertips and I'm able to grab a hold of it and use it. Sorry, it doesn't work that way for me. Maybe it works that way for the fortunate few in here that have it, but it doesn't work that way for me. Sometimes I have to really, really search to find that. And the search is often through unacceptance. Is not accepting the situation will lead me to accepting it. And see, that's the other thing that was so revealed, is the power of paradox. You see, I never understood that change was paradoxical in its nature. I always had this kind of very simplistic idea that, you know, change was linear, that if you wanted something, you started at A and you go to B. And you're just supposed to do it that way. And if you didn't do it that way, it meant you weren't motivated enough or whatever it was. I mean, I can't believe how psychologically naive that sounds today. If that was the case, I'd be out of business. There would be no need for therapists. All you'd have to do is say, hey, I want this to happen. It would happen, right? Power of positive thinking. All you got to do is have the intention. It's going to take place. Well, sometimes that works. Not often enough for me. There's a lot of other forces that are involved. And see, that was part of, I think, what was revealed to me over these 53 years, is that this whole idea that I was in control of my life was an incredible illusion. I was not nearly as control of things as I thought I was. There were so many forces that were operating in me that were outside of my awareness. The big one, and then we'll get here into step five in a little bit, was that early on in my life, for good reasons, I had to become invulnerable. And that happened at 11 years old, right after my father died. And that there was nobody really in my close proximity that was able to be there and comfort me. My mom was devastated by the loss of her husband, who was only 39 years old. She had four children, and she had less than an eighth grade education. She was overwhelmed and totally overtaken by her guilt and fear. My grandfather, it was his only son, and he was totally devastated. That he kept saying to me, I still remember, you know, hearing these words. This is not how life is supposed to be. You're supposed to, your son is supposed to bury you. You're not supposed to bury your son. Now, does that give you some insight in terms of the messages I got? That life was supposed to be a certain way. And if it wasn't that way, guess what? Something was wrong. There was never let's figure out how to deal with this and see what we can do to deal with this as it is. There was none of that concern. There was a deep objection and anger and self-pity about the situation. So it's no wonder I didn't have any of these tools. Today I understand that. But at that point in time, if nobody's around, guess what it meant? I've got to become self-reliant. I've got to figure this out. I'm on my own. From that point on, at 11 years old, it was me against the world. And you know, that's 11-year-old boy. That's a big order for anyone, even somebody that's a lot older, to be able to have think about, I've got to figure this all out on my own. And one of the revelations I've had with what I've gone through the last couple of years was that from that point on, my life became a test of my invulnerability. I was going to go through life and nothing was going to get to me, and I wasn't going to let anyone be important to me, and I was going to be able to enter any situation and conquer it. And so going into the Marine Corps at 17 seemed like a good idea, right? I can be one of the proud Marines. Well, that's the journey that was on. And look, I am so grateful that all of this has been revealed to me, so that I can start to discover some new possibilities. And that's what I see recovery as today, is the discovery of new possibilities. That's what our quest is can we figure out some new ways to now cope with and deal with situations that are challenging and baffling to us? And can we do it so that when we come out the other end, that we're got a lot more than what we had when we started, when we started that journey, whatever it was. And this is the big thing, is that when you experience a situation that takes away so much from you, how can you digest it to be able to give yourself more than it's taken away? See, that's the magic of recovery, is to be able to meet a situation that drops you to your knees, that you don't know how you're going to be able to get up the next day and cope with what's going on, with the devastation, whether it's a loss or some other kind of experience that has just deconstructed your world. How can we meet that experience and find a way to take it and use it to help us become more than we were when we started? See, that's the magic of recovery. And that's the magic that you're going to find and you're going to discover if you start to dig into emotional sobriety. That in essence is what emotional sobriety is about. It's about magic. It's about magic. It's about discovering magic. So thanks for letting me share a little bit of my birthday with you today. It's been an amazing journey, and I hope to see you guys in 53 more years. We'll shoot for it. Now, sometimes, Susie, you think I can be a little unreasonable? No, huh? You don't think so at all? Yeah, I think so. I can be really unreasonable. I can be outrageous, as a matter of fact. Okay. I just got a message from Jan. She says her sobriety date is August 1st as well in 2020. Wonderful. Happy birthday partner. Great, Jan. Thanks for sharing. I didn't know that. That's wonderful. So let's dig into the steps, right? That's what we're here to talk about today. And I want to always step back and take a kind of zoom out for a minute and take a look at the process that's involved, okay? Because there is an energy, a psychological energy that gets created once we start to work the steps. And let's just see what happens in step one. And what you're going to see is the energy follows this formula. The steps create an incredible tension, a powerful tension. And as you know, if you're tense, what the movement is to want to move away from that tension, is to resolve it, to become relaxed. So it goes from a charge of tension, to a discharge that creates a relaxation. And if you think about life, life is just that way, right? We charge ourselves with an inhalation. We relax by exhaling. We charge and discharge. There's a reason why these steps seem to be divinely inspired, because they capture the essence of what it means to be a human being, what it means to be alive. Is our whole life is based on that very simple formula that starts out very simplistic, right? But becomes much more and more complex as we go through life. So how does that first step do it? Well, first step is we admitted we were powerless over alcohol or whatever. If you're in NA, we admitted we were powerless over our addiction and that our lives had become unmanageable. So here is the charge or the tension that's being created. I have a serious problem. And I, within the resources I currently have available to me, I have no way of dealing with this. And if I don't find a solution to it, I'm going to die probably from this. What are we told the outcome of this thing is? Is death, institutionalization, or jail? Or living a life of complete misery, which might be worse than death in many ways. So here I am. I've got this situation that I got a serious problem. I've created this. I have no idea what I'm going to do to be able to now figure this thing out. Everything I've tried doesn't work. I am powerless. And not only that, that I've been living my life where I thought I was managing things, it's really unmanageable and it's a mess. And this was well before the addiction set in. What a dilemma. What an incredible dilemma. I say, and you've heard me say this before if you've been tuned into some of our other talks, is that it creates an existential crisis. The first step creates an existential crisis. An existential crisis is when you're letting go of something that hasn't been working, but you don't have anything new to hold on to. You're betwixt and between. Well, that existential crisis creates an existential anxiety. And if you're anxious, you know how much you want to get that taken care of. You want to resolve that anxiety and find some solution to it as fast as possible. It's like being on fire. Somebody, please put this thing out. So there's an incredible charge when we first take step one that starts to build an energy that is going to propel us through these 12 steps. And that's why it's so important to not move too quickly past step one. Because you have to let that charge build. You have to accept this down to your very fiber, what the truth is about what you've created in your life. Well, do you see how it sets us up for what's going to happen in the next step? We got a charge, right? Now we need a resolution to that. What's the resolution to powerlessness, to helplessness, to hopelessness? You guys know what it is. It's the installation of hope. It's my God, there is a solution. Came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. That's the installation of hope. There's some possibility out here. I don't know what it is. But there is a possibility out here that I can live a different life. That I can find a way to be a part of this world and to make it work differently than it has up to this point in time. So step two resolves the crisis that was created in step one. But it's going to create a new crisis. Because my God, I want hope now. Where the hell do I find it? How do I find this? What do I have to do to turn this hope, which is a fantasy, into a reality? So there's a new crisis or a new charge, right? You can see that a new tension builds. Wow, I want this. Now what? How does that happen? What's going to happen? What's the reality? What do I have to do? And what happens in step three? Right? Made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. There's a resolution to the tension. You see it? Made a decision. It's a very, very important thing to make that decision to commit yourself to a new way of life, a life that's based on a whole different set of principles than before. We'll go back to that unmanageability issue, because when we say our lives have become unmanageable, it means the whole trajectory of our life has been heading us for trouble way early on in our life. But early on in our life, if you're 2 degrees off, you don't realize the impact it's going to have until you live that for about 40 years. That being 2 degrees off after 40 years becomes what? You remember, was it Apollo 13 that was shooting back to the Earth and they had a few seconds to get this burn right. And if they burned too long, they were going to go one way. If they didn't burn long enough, they were going to miss and they would be off and heading towards the sun. Same thing with our life. That little 2 degrees at one point in time, a million miles away from now, is going to be huge miles. And that's what happened to us. Those ideas that we accept, that we internalized and that were given to us and that our culture gives to us, and all it's from many different sources, we didn't realize how it was going to create an impossible way of life until we're much older and we try to live those things. And now we see the results. So make a decision. There's a resolution to now I know what I need to do to get hope. I've made that decision, but now what do I have to do? I've made a decision. What's next? Oh, great. See, another charge. And that's where step comes from. All right, well, make a searching and fearless moral inventory of yourself. Here it is. We're given a new task, right? You want that? You want to realize this hope? You want to realize this new way of life? This is what you have to start to do. You have to develop an awareness. And that's a very important thing. Two things happen in step four. You get your curiosity stoked about who you are, and you become interested in yourself in a very different way than you've ever been interested before. Curiosity is engendered in step four, as well as an awareness of who you are, and even more importantly, who you're not yet. But it has to be searching and fearless, because you cannot let your self-hate stop you from looking at things that you don't want to see. It takes a hell of a commitment and discipline to own and look at the things that you don't want to see, that you don't like about yourself, and that you don't want to admit. And it takes a lot of self-support and support from other people, hopefully a great sponsor, a good therapist or a clergyman or whoever that's there and helping you as you're working through that step. But once again, here's the charge, right? It's discharged that we're making a commitment. Now, what do I have to do? Now you got to do the inventory. That resolves it. Okay, I see what I need to do. But now I've got this awareness of myself. I've taken a look at myself. Now, what do I do? Admit to ourselves and to another human being, admit to ourselves, to God, and another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs. Now, if you were with us, I encourage people to do a fourth step inventory from a very different perspective, not the traditional one you'll see in the big book or with a lot of other people, but with looking at, if you take this concept of emotional dependence and you inventory what that's done to your life, you are going to start to identify the exact nature of your wrongs, or what Bill Wilson called your basic flaw. Because our basic flaw had been what he called dependence, almost absolute dependence on people and circumstances for prestige, security, and the like. That's how he said it. So if we make that inventory and we start to see how this emotional dependency, our lack of maturity, which is a developmental problem, it's not that there's something wrong with you, you're stuck. We don't want to pathologize. It's such a danger in the program to think that there's something wrong with us. We're stuck. That's what's wrong with us. What's wrong with us is there's something right about us that you can't realize unless you get unstuck. And when you get stuck, then what's right about you creates all kinds of problems, because it's begging you to get unstuck. It's begging you to keep moving towards what you can be. That's our dis-ease, is that we are not honoring ourselves. And that makes us sick. It's a sickness of the soul. And it manifests itself in a lot of different ways. So admit it to ourselves. Wow. Now, here's the thing. What does it mean to admit to yourself the exact nature of your wrongs? Well, this is where you have to step back and take a look at how does my dependency, my emotional dependency, impact my life? And what does it mean? Well, if we start to get honest and we really admit to ourselves the exact nature of our wrongs, we realize that we have made all kinds of unconscious demands and claims on how life is supposed to be for us to be okay. That is the, you want to get down to the exact nature of our wrongs, is demanding that life be what we think it needs to be for us to be okay. You see, that creates all kinds of problems, all kinds of issues in our life that manifest themselves in all kinds of different ways. Well, notice self-reliance is involved in all of that, isn't it? Life has got to be what I want it to be for it's going to be what I demand it to be for me to be okay. Well, good luck with that, Alan. Yeah, right. You know where that leads. A lot of struggle, right? We step on our toes of our fellows and they retaliate. Life retaliates. Life is not going to cooperate with what we want it to be. Life is just going to be what it is. Reality is what it is. Only, as Byron Katie has made us all aware of, something we're all aware of, life, reality is only reality 100% of the time. That's what it is. Our problem is I don't want to accept reality as it is. So we start to admit to ourselves that, my God, I get hung up on this. This is where I'm really creating my own, right, my own existence. This is where I create my own symptoms, my own difficulties in relationships. I don't know how to get along with other people. By being demanding and having these claims on how things are supposed to be, and then those turn into, so this is the path, by the way. It starts out with that I have this idea that life has to be a certain way for me to be okay. And that, you know, I want to be loved and I want to be accepted. So now I think somehow the path to that is going to be, to me, be in a certain way. So we accept this idea that, okay, if I'm just a nice guy all the time, everything's going to work out. So let's say I take that on as somehow as my path, right? That's the, my resolution to this basic desire to be in loved and accepted and belonging. Well, with that comes all kinds of claims and demands. Claims I make on life is that if I'm nice, you're going to have to respond to me in a certain way. The demands I make are going to be on myself to be a certain way all the time. Now, because if I said, I demand that you accept me this way and that you respond that way, I would hear how outrageous I am. I wouldn't be able to pull it off with you, would I? First of all, you wouldn't probably buy it if you were healthy in any way and say, man, I'm not here to, you know, I'm not going to buy your demands. You know, that's not what a relationship is about. But we're not going to be able to experience the rawness of those claims and demands. So we convert them into expectations. And we believe our expectations are normal. And therefore, if they're normal, it's okay that I generate these unenforceable rules that I expect, not expect, but remember, expect is rooted in what? Demand, that I demand that you adhere to. And I have those unenforceable rules for you. I have them for me. There should demands, the way you think about them. But we don't see them as such because we don't, we wouldn't be able, we, our mind couldn't wrap our head around what we're doing to ourselves. It would be incongruent. It would create a dissonance. So we make them normal. We play a big game on ourselves. And that's where it comes to admitting to ourselves the exact nature, but admitting to another human being. Because when I sit with someone who I like to call our enlightened witness, see, we all need to be witnessed. And being witnessed after we do step four is so important because we're still going to have a lot of blind spots and things that we can't see. And we're going to be talking about things and sharing things, and we're not going to be able to connect some of the dots. But you know what? If you have an enlightened witness, guess what they do? They help connect the dots for you. We can do what I can't do. That's the message here. We're now starting to undo some of the self-reliance that each and every one of us have had. That enlightened witness starts to point out to me things that I was unaware of. And so once again, this curiosity that got started to get stoked in step four, and my awareness continues to get stoked and really, really increases with what I do in step five. Now, what we know is the truth will set us free. And step five is about speaking the truth, about truth speaking, but only if we have the courage to live it, which means we can speak the truth, but we have to find the courage to say the truth. And that means going up against a lot of our own should demands and facing ourselves. I'll tell you, it was very interesting getting clean and sober in the Marine Corps. Because not one Marine that was getting clean and sober would admit that they had any fear while they were in Vietnam. Because it meant you were a coward. That's some of the crazy ideas that the guys had that I started to work with. That's first people I worked with in the field as a counselor was Vietnam combat veterans. And there were certain things about them and their experience that they could never admit to themselves because it wasn't their image of what it meant to be a good Marine, right? So these are the things we're facing. So do you see what starts to happen in step four? I take this inventory and I sit with it and now there's a charge. My God, what am I going to do with this? We're going to share it. We're going to share it with other people. And in that sharing it, we start to realize that there's value in our community and being a part of our community. And that by me being vulnerable, I create a very different space. See, that step is also about discovering the value of authenticity and vulnerability in our relationships. For many of us, step five is the first time we've ever been this open and honest with another person in our whole life. That was my case. Never had I shared the things with another human being that I shared with my sponsor. And he made it safe. And I will say that that's important too, to understand the value of being safe in a relationship. But once again, I didn't think I needed that. I was what? Mr. Invulnerable. Test of my invulnerability. I don't need to feel safe. I'll just do it anyway. No, there's a different thing that happens when you share yourself with someone you feel safe with. A lot of people have taken steps four with people they don't feel safe with. Not a good idea. You're not going to get the maximum therapeutic benefit and value of that step. Because what it does is it reunites us with our humanity. And if you really, with an enlightened witness, that person is going to say, like my sponsor did, and say, God, I know you feel terrible about that, but let me share something about myself and the experience I had. And then all of a sudden, I realize that the stuff I've been going through and the stuff I've been struggling with is stuff that we're all, that's universal to the experience of being human. I'm not that fucking special. Oh my God, what a revelation. It was great and bad at the same time. You know what I mean? It was one of these things like good news and bad news. Good news is you're not special. Bad news, you're not special. No, I am special in my own crazy, unique way, just like each and every one of us. There's not going to be another you that's ever going to exist on this planet. There will be never another person exactly like you because, you know, that you're a combination of your parents coming together and them bringing what they brought. Nobody's ever going to recreate that in your life. So you're incredibly special. But we're not unique. We share a lot of similar experiences in this you as being a human, comma, being. I like to write it that way. A human, comma, being. That's what we are. Well, if emotional sobriety is about freedom, you can see that in this step, we start to drop some of those bars that we've been holding in our life that have created the prison. And what we do is we start to liberate ourselves from these ideas of that we have about how we should be, and we start to face ourselves and accept ourselves as we are. Doesn't mean we don't continue to strive to become what we can be. We do. But you can't become what you can be until you accept who you are. It's not going to happen. Back to that paradoxical theory of change. By owning 100% who I am, and it doesn't just happen in me doing it as a soliloquy, doing it with just by myself. I need to say it out loud to you, that as my enlightened witness, to really hear it. There's an incredible value to saying these things out loud. That's another, such an important dimension of step five, is we give voice to this. We start to develop the ability, which none of us have really paid attention to, is to developing what I like to call a personal language. And see, step five is the beginning of that journey on developing this personal language. Now, what is a personal language? A personal language is your ability to be able to find the words that most accurately express what you're experiencing and who you are, as well as finding the courage to speak them. That is a necessary condition for intimacy. If I'm unable to be authentic with you, we can't have an intimate relationship. It's not going to happen. It can't just be a fantasy, ladies and gentlemen, and most of us would like it to be. Oh my God, we'll just find that right person and we have this wonderful intimacy. Well, good luck with that. Nope. It takes you being able to find the words that most accurately express where you're at. And the reality is not many of us have been invited to do that. Not many of us feel like, I really am interested in you and what you're experiencing and what's going on with you and how you are in this world and what it means to you to be in this world and and what you're struggling with and what you hope for and what you'd like different. See, we haven't been invited to operate in that space before. And that's what step five is doing. It's creating this incredible opportunity for authenticity, for true speaking, to be real, to be who you are, without having to be someone that you're not. Isn't that what we've all wanted? Isn't that what was important to each and every one of us, to find that in some way in this world? Is to feel like there was room for me in this world to be in a relationship with someone to be? You see, step five is now introducing us to some of the elements of what a healthy relationship is all about. And it's based on this kind of authentic relating and being able to talk to someone and really open ourselves up and discover what's going on. And to be able to share it with someone else. I think that one of the things that I learned in terms of the exact nature of my wrongs was that probably the best diagnosis that would have captured all of my struggles would have been ignorance. And I don't say that as putting myself down. I say that more as just a reality. I didn't know a lot of things about myself and about life. And truth is, I didn't want to know a lot of things about myself and life either. I was living in a fantasy and thinking that somehow staying asleep would be a good solution. But I realized that was part of my ignorance too, not realizing the importance of waking up. Step five is a continuance is a better way to say it, of our awakening. that we start to wake up to ourselves, to this world, to our relationships, to the importance of them, and to the possibilities that none of us realized that could have existed. So let me invite my dear friend Herb in to see if he'd like to discuss anything of what I've said. I know Herb's going to do his own little shtick on step five here in the next month, and then we're going to come back together in a couple months. But I hope that the way I've talked about step five for you is kind of help you look at it in a different way, right? And in a more textured way, right? And seeing some of the nuances, right? And subtleties that are going on in this step into power. Now, remember what I said. While this step is resolving the tension of step four that occurred, right? When I start to see all this shit, what am I going to do with it now? And I'm sharing it. Now it leads us to something else. Now I've said it out loud. I can't go back to sleep, right? So now I'm led to step six. Well, we'll get to that. But you see, this is part of that awakening I was telling you about. That's the charge. Now I'm awake. Oh my God, I see all this stuff. What the hell am I going to do with all of this? Right? And that's where now step six and seven are going to help get us, right? They're going to orient us in terms of, I'll just give you a quick preview, in terms of developing the best possible attitude towards yourself, towards your relationships, and towards life. That's also a great description of emotional sobriety. Developing the best possible attitude towards yourself, towards your relationships, and towards life. You'll hear me say often, when we're emotionally sober, the best of us speaks for the rest of us. I mean, the best of us speaks for the rest of us. And just one other thought is that only the best in us can see the worst in us. And that's the other thing we're realizing. That's what step four and five are really helping us get in touch with, right? We're going to look at some things that are hard to look at. The self-centeredness, the fact that we've betrayed people's trust and hurt them and ripped them off, become liars and done all these other things. There are things that are horrible in one degree, but they're also very much a part of this experience of of getting lost in this world. Anyway, enough said. Herb, I was inviting you in and I kept talking. Sorry about that.
That's wonderful. And thank you, Alan, very much. Of course, you've prompted me to make 4 pages of notes.
Always happens.
Exactly. Wonderful, wonderful. So obviously, I'm going to have to just be very laser focused here in just a couple of the comments. Number one, it's an incredible insight that we have, you and I, to the steps to say that they're built specifically for human development. We don't need actually really to talk much about spirituality. We do, and I'm comfortable with it, but anybody out there that's not, it's okay. This is a human development process. My experience, and it's not one and done, by the way. You do a fourth step and a fifth step, and then you finish your ninth step and you go on walking in the park. No, that's, first of all, that's not my experience. All of the even steps are naming steps, as I see it. All of the odd steps are decision and action steps. That's what Alan was talking about. The fourth step, Bill invites us. I mean, he's very succinct in his vocabulary, and you have to get really underneath it and unpack it because it's so rich, very dense, his language. Whether it was intentional or not, it doesn't matter, but that's how I've experienced his language. In the fourth step, he invites us to get to the exact nature of our wrong. Not to list our behavior and our thoughts and our feelings, although we do that. But those are just symptoms of the underlying issue. What's the exact nature? The exact nature. What's the source and the flow? And he revealed that to me in the big book when I was 10 or 12 years sober, going through the work the third time as the unmanageability. But I didn't know that. And Alan made the comment, we can't see that we don't see, and we don't know that we don't know until we do. And this process is a very organic flow process. I heard a speaker say, you can't make a tulip grow by pulling on. It's such a simplistic statement, and yet it's absolutely a description of the growth that we experience over time, a lot of time. One of my other friends said, step four and five is actually step one in writing. Step one, that implosion in complete defeat. I need help. I mean, on my own, I'm screwed. I need help. Step four and five really put flesh on the skeleton of that. And my own experience early on, I didn't know that it was an experience until later on, was that when I wrote it out, I had some implication. I saw some direction when I wrote it out. But when I read it out, I had an experience. It's a huge difference from knowledge to experience. The difference being knowledge is in the head, experience is in the heart, and transfers to the feet eventually in terms of a radical transformation. And I believe, and Alan made the point, and he connected it to emotional sobriety, which is down the road for most of us. Bill didn't write about emotional sobriety, Bill Wilson, until he was 20 years sober. Alan and I began writing it about 20 years ago. He was 30 years sober. I was 20 years sober, thinking about and writing about, because in fact, we weren't ready for it. Well, at least I'll speak for myself. And the point is, and I saw it first in the fourth step and then experienced it in the fifth step, I'm responsible for my life. And Alan made the trifecta observation. Please hear this. It's a great insight to the steps in terms of human development. Those first three steps are for a relationship with life, with reality. The next four steps are a relationship with ourself. We're talking about four and five, the key steps to that relationship. And the next two or three steps, if you include 10, eight, nine, maybe 10, are for our relationship with others. Relationship with reality as it is. And the outcome for me, and what Alan talked about, of four and five is I'm responsible. And it's embarrassing to see the truth of the impact of my thoughts and feelings, but especially my behavior, my impact of my behavior on myself, let alone on other people. And for me, the healthy outcome, the healthy experience, the healthy awakening of four and five is to go, oh, wow, I'm responsible for my life and I can't do it on my own. And I need help. However you translate that into practicality, it doesn't matter whether it's therapy and or spirituality or a combination of both. I think the combination is always more healthy. But I'm responsible for my thoughts, knowing better, for my feelings, feeling better, for my actions, doing better. I'm responsible 100%. And the invitation, and you won't read it in the big book this way, and please don't say it too publicly in meetings until you're ready to receive a lot of flack. I am responsible to manage my life. No, 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 that's the invitation. I've become very bold in the last 3 years of saying that. The invitation is for me to manage my life. Not on my own. I have a managing partner. The spirit of the universe, I plug in every morning for guidance to be in alignment with the flow of reality as it manifests on a daily basis. And that fourth and fifth step set us up for that eventual realization, as Alan made the comment, realization. Real. making it real, making I real, where I fit. I am unique, but I'm not unique. And what's that balance? That's emotional sobriety, that balance of independence in the milieu of interdependence. I'm going to stop because I've got so many notes. You're very stimulated, Alan. You and I could go on for a while, and maybe that was helpful supplement to the wonderful insights that you had. Thank you.